Mary Hoffia messed with vision of plague, a deficit, or some people would say a deficiency of the money that giant corporations should be reeling in. Introducing the horrifically overpriced Kimba the White Lion. Except that my piggy bank wouldn't cooperate. So instead we have to settle with the infinitely inferior ripoff of a ripoff, the feline monarch. Let's dive in and see if it's worth purging your wallet on a lion, another lion, and what's left of Mufasa. Frankly, the sole reason I and anybody over the age of 4 bought this set is because of the admittedly gorgeous lion, an all-new variation on the prepubescent big cat mode. The mane is immaculately detailed, though not to excess such that it will be a fairy Medusa. More extraordinary is the level of consistency maintained for the lioness, albeit with one major exception, that being the size of the eye. In comparison, the lioness looks as if it escaped from an anime. I don't know if the minute pupil results from LEGO only being able to print on a tiny section of the head, or an artistic decision. However, it is distracting nonetheless. That aside, the two felines are cut from the same cloth, even retaining an identical muzzle design and iris color. My biggest issue with the set is one ubiquitous among LEGO animals. LEGO loves to carve out the insides of legs, bellies, arms, and other slightly less noticeable areas. While it does not instantly jump out to the casual viewer, once you see it, you can't unsee it. This isn't an intentional design quirk. In LEGO's official animation, said depressions are filled in. Therefore, I can only assume that it's a cost-saving measure, which given that this is a $45 premium product, reeks of stinginess. Considering that these holes serve no function, unlike the anti-studs at the back of minifigure legs, and how that element is meant to represent a living, breathing organism, the carved out section strikes me as quite unsettling. Insert seamless segue. Oh, I'm not meant to read that. The cub is cute, end of story, the mode is dynamic, the proportions are pleasing, the details are spot on, I have no qualms. Significantly less kawaii, but miles more technically impressive is the snake. Given that LEGO's printing quality is plummeting off an inkblot cliff, I was surprised by the crispness of the constricted stripes, especially given the unevenness of the application surface. The precision of the eye alignment is equally worthy of praise, in which case what the hell happened to my T-Rex? The mode of the boa constrictor is flawless with a clearly defined lower jaw, beautifully unmodulated curves I like Helvetica, and the discreetly integrated bar. Also, and this is a Nobel-worthy discovery, the snake can fly. Which transitions nicely into the Achilles heel of the set, the I wouldn't pay a dollar for them builds. Beginning with the eponymous off-roader, it's efficient at best. I understand the target audience is 4-year-olds, still that's no excuse for an unfinished looking model. The number of exposed connection points and inexplicable grid lanes embarrassing. Would have been too much effort to cover up the studs on the sides, or devise a reasonable looking rear. These taillights are L-shaped and partially directed at the sky. Moreover, the black plates of clips are... what are they meant to represent? I'm completely flummoxed. Then there's the front grille, the most essential part of any vehicle. To me, this area is the face of the car, the region that conveys its personality. The personality of 60301 is slapdash bug, and not in the cutesy VW Beetle way, rather an I'm bound by these ridiculous 4+ limitations way, more on that later. Likewise, the trans blue and red is an off-putting grey, and the robot is so hideously undersized and elevated that it looks out of place. And of course, Kaka has a double chin. At this point, I'm beating a dead horse. What little positivity I can spew from my venomous mouth refers to the accessories stashed in the back, chiefly the baby bottle to feed the cub, the mere idea of which is irresistibly cute. The winch is also fabulous, incorporating immense play value into a tiny 2x4 area. Further sweetening the deal, the winch utilizes chains instead of the strings I can never tie. My copy even came with an extra chain, although this may be a production fluke. It's definitely a production fluke. The quality control department was lacking more than the model team, can you believe that? Firstly, a black Technic pin was substituted for 1x2 red tile to shine yet more light on this sorry box on wheels. Secondly, the instructions are... people would mistake them for one of my instructions! There are an inordinate amount of errors, including and not limited to the line cup changing positions between steps, the constrictor popping out without a parts call out, and 22 missing part number zeros. Speeding past with a water scooter. Before I sink my teeth into the delectable main course, we have a campsite aperitif. As a vignette, it's not too bad. The tree trunk is a fine example of nice parts usage, the canopy does not deserve to be mentioned, and the creative accessories greatly expand role-playing scenarios. Additionally, there's the obligatory red mug, here unceremoniously deposited on the grass. The campfire, meanwhile, is so ludicrously oversized that it can double as a flamethrower. Small's no more. For a company that prides itself on fostering creativity, 90% of the scenery relies on huge preformed elements. There are 3 road plates, 2 giant curve plates, 1 1x2x5 pillar, and 6 small ugly rock pieces. Beyond aesthetics and functionality, the most infuriating aspect of the set is the value, or lack thereof, of the build experience. Because as it stands, you get more construction out of IKEA furniture. The obvious rebuttal is that 4-year-olds lack the patience and dexterity to handle larger, more complex sets. But children aren't idiots and should you believe so, meticulous handholding isn't doing them any favours. Besides, part of the fun of LEGO is the challenge, however limited it may be. Personally, that challenge is digging through and locating the appropriate elements. Although it annoys me to no end, LEGO is frequently mischaracterized as a puzzle. While this is quite reductive as unlike puzzles, the pieces aren't limited to a singular position and usage. They both elicit the same satisfaction from seeing a larger model gradually take shape during an enjoyable, mildly difficult process. Unfortunately, through giant preform modes, 4 plus sets eliminate any semblance of that challenge, consequently removing the gratification upon completion. It's as if LEGO equated building to hassle and thus removed all the extra construction. Back in the early 2000s, the company attempted a similar dumbed-down gamble, most egregiously in the Jack Stone line. Then LEGO was facing what can be euphemistically termed financial difficulties, believing that the kids of today were so attention-deprived to no longer possess an attention span of more than 5 seconds. The high-ups of the Brick Company overhauled the entire product line to involve as little assembly as possible. The irony speaks for itself. So as everything I say ends up a tangent, the argument for oversimplified 4 plus sets holds as much weight as the Kimba-Simba parallels. Lastly, there's no way the set is worth $45 in content or experience. Besides, LEGO's recommended retail price, like all manufacturers, is purposely inflated to accommodate discounts. Please only purchase Wildlife Rescue Off the Walls Rotor on sale. Close enough, if you enjoy my content and can endure my pretentious waffle, please consider subscribing and enabling notifications. And while you're there, swipe up to leave a like and swipe down to drop a comment, it'll be much appreciated. Till next millennium, keep on building.